Good morning, all. I am Rohit John, and I welcome all of you to today's talk on halide perovskite membranes for neuromorphic computing and hardware security. Before beginning, I would like to thank Prof. Ankur Solanki for this invitation and Prof. Gogoi for the very kind introduction. Since this conference is a specialized conference focusing on perovskite devices such as membranes and transistors, I think I will skip the introduction to what are membranes and what are perovskites. So today we will initially discuss, or I'll give you a brief introduction on different flavors of membranes, and then we will discuss our results on perovskite membrane implementation as nociceptors, synapses, and then physical unclonable functions. So as all of you are aware, membranes are resistive materials and devices whose present state depends on their previous history. Depending on the charge transport physics, it is possible to design membranes that work on the electrochemical metallization mechanism. It is possible to design membranes that work on the migration of vacancies. We can design membranes that work on the transition between an amorphous and crystalline phase. We can have membranes who work on the basis of polarization or even redox reactions. Irrespective of which technology you choose to favor, there are two key takeaway messages. The first message is that new materials and devices have a very crucial role to play in this regard. And the second message is that halide perovskite as a material platform kind of supports all these mechanisms, and hence there is a lot of research to be done in this field. We can also classify membranes based on their functionality into non-volatile, which means the information is restored even when you lose power. Even in this classification, we can have devices that store only two resistance states. These are called binary or digital. We can have membranes which store multiple resistance states. These are called analog membranes. Or we can also design membranes which lose their information upon removing power. These are called volatile membranes. For brain-inspired computing slash information storage, each of these devices or technologies have a crucial role to play, and we will see most of them in today's talk. Finally, we can also classify membranes based on what application we are targeting. So today, I will focus my talk on perovskite membrane implementation, specifically regarding spiking neural networks as well as physical unclonable functions. With regards to implementations of spiking neural networks, we look for inspiration from biology. So we look for studies from neuroscientists who study how actual neurons and synapses work in the brain. And then we try to electrically map them onto our devices. It can be membranes, it can be mem transistors, and can be any material that we are interested in. Again, the key takeaway messages from biology is that computing occurs in the form of spikes and not continuously streamed data. And the information is encoded in the timing of spikes and also the spike rate. This can happen at multiple timescales, and when it happens in the short timescale, it is called paired pulse facilitation. And when it happens in the long-term timescale, it's called spike timing dependent plasticity. These are the basic characteristics that we use to benchmark our membranes on in order to pitch neuromorphic computing or learning. And there are several other paraphernalia and associations along with these terms as well. A key concept that we have tried to push in this field from our lab at NTU is the concept of mixed ionic electronic conduction. So as opposed to a standard metal insulator metal architecture where the perovskite only acts as a host for migration of either a silver or aluminum or reactive species, we take inspiration from a solar cell or a light emitting diode configuration where we have transport layers surrounding the perovskite layer. So in this kind of configuration, the concept that we are trying to push is the polarization of these interfaces. So when we apply a bias, we can have the positive ions in the perovskite moving to one interface and the negative ions moving to the other interface and causing polarization at these interfaces. When we have this polarization, it is possible to modulate the injection barrier or Schottky barrier at these interfaces and have charge carrier trapping, which would result in small stable changes in conductance. This is the concept that we have been trying to push in our lab for achieving synapses very specifically. So to reiterate, when we apply a bias, the ions can drift towards the interface. This can cause a change in the injection barrier of that particular interface, and due to carrier trapping, we get a non-volatile state. When we remove the power, the ions can diffuse back to their normal state, and hence we can modulate this drift and back diffusion based on the amplitude of the voltage that we apply, the pulse interval, pulse width, and so on, so forth. So very logically, in such configurations, the interfaces play a major role because interfaces essentially determine your charge transport physics in whatever device that you're investigating. So for example, in this recently published work, we investigate methyl ammonium lead bromide along with hole transporting layers, electron transporting layers, BOT2T, and we compare two hole transporting layers, one P dot PSS and one nickel oxide. And we find that P dot PSS based devices show a very volatile behavior or a diffusive behavior, which means you can push in ions to one side, but they drift back and they diffuse back to their original state quite fast. However, with nickel oxide, the hole transporting layer, this behavior is more non-volatile and it's a drift dominated rather than back diffusion. So in short, with P dot devices, we could get diffusive or volatile behavior. And with nickel oxide devices, we could get drift or non-volatile behavior. We resort to impedance spectroscopy as well as electron microscopy to understand what is going on. So here we have secondary electron images as well as backscattered electron images of both nickel oxide and P dot PSS devices before and after bias. So with secondary electron images, you don't see any difference between P dot and the nickel oxide, but with backscattered images, we see that with P dot, even when you compare the biased devices versus the freshly made devices, you don't see any difference in the interface. But with nickel oxide, you can start to see domains of lead bromide formed at the interface between the perovskite and the nickel oxide layer. This kind of points out to filamentary formation, even despite the presence of this charge transport layer of nickel oxide. So we hypothesize that P dot, in P dot based devices, we have this ion accumulation towards one interface, but P dot effectively screens those ions or does not allow them to penetrate through P dot. However, with nickel oxide, we believe that there is a filament formation formed by the halide vacancies or the halogen ions. And moreover, from literature, we know that oxygen vacancies in oxides such as nickel oxide can also form a filament. So in short, again, P dot based devices could give us volatile behavior and nickel oxide based devices could give us non-volatile behavior. So what could we now do with this? So like I mentioned before, each device technology has its own use case. So with the diffusive or volatile perovskite memristors, we created what are known as artificial nociceptors. So nociceptors are actually sensory neurons that are present in our human skin. So if you consider human skin cells as an array of mechanoreceptors, there are sensory neurons attached to every mechanoreceptor. It is these receptors that help us to determine pain. So for example, if you touch the tip of a sharp knife, or if we touch a hot pan, the immediate reaction that we have is because of the functioning of what are called as nociceptors. And if you take a look at their behavior, they function based on short-term memory. So with our P dot based devices, we could now emulate nociceptors very faithfully. So we connected our perovskite devices to pressure sensors. And then when we press the pressure sensor, the pressure is translated into different amplitude of input voltages or different pulse width of input voltages or different pulse intervals. So we could now modulate our device based on any of these schemes. So for example, if you focus only on graph A here, the different pressure stimuli is converted to different amplitudes of voltages. This, when input to our device, gives us a different response. So we have a higher output response with a higher input voltage, which is very logical. And this is very similar to what is called hyperalgesia in biology. And more interestingly, the threshold voltage or threshold current required to reach an emergency response level can be also shifted. And this is very similar, again, to what is seen in biology called allodynia. And this is just a rudimentary implementation. Like I said, we can now translate this pressure stimuli into pulse width, pulse interval, and based on all these things, we can arrive at a conclusion or demonstrate learning. With our NIOX devices, since they are non-volatile, we could implement synapses. And this is the standard STDP kind of characterization you see in almost all papers. And we could now simulate neural networks based on the STDP behavior. What is more interesting for us is that because now we could now modulate volatile or non-volatile behavior with perovskite devices, now we could now implement a system where we integrate sensors to nociceptors. Nociceptors would allow us to sense harmful stimuli. It could now build up associative memory with our synapses. We could now interface it to CMOS neurons, and also finally, possibly integrate with the, again, actuators, and hence make an entire system to demonstrate real-time learning. And this is technically called in-sensory computing, which is basically, which means we are trying to perform computation at the location of the sensors rather than sending it to a central processor. With that, I would like to show you a video. So here we have our nociceptors, perovskite memory cells as nociceptors, perovskite synapses, the memory cells as synapses. We have connected them to a CMOS neuron, which is under this box. And then we have integrated it onto the body of a robot, and we have pressure sensors here. So initially, the system works fine. When we touch the pressure sensor, when we pinch, the system is able to work properly. However, if training is not properly done, the system does not learn anything. So to show that, we remove this wired connection before training is done. And then we show that the system has not developed an associative memory, and hence it has not learned anything. Now we restore the connection. Now all the system is connected. So, and then we perform the training. Our nociceptors help us to detect this harmful pressure stimuli. Our synapses develop associative memory over time, and we need to do this training two times at least in our case. And to prove that there is an associative memory developed, we remove this connection. And now by right, the system should not work. It should work only if there is a memory. And because it works now, we can prove that we can demonstrate real-time learning with these devices. And hence, there is a real memory or associative memory being developed between the nociceptors and synapses. Of course, we have also investigated normal metal insulator metal structures for implementing binary or digital memory cells. However, again, to prevent too fast degradation of perovskites, we always like to encapsulate it with some polymeric layers such as PMMA. And with these devices, we were able to realize digital memory cells or binary memory cells with reasonably good endurance. And we can make them flexible, bendable, and several form factors. And in these devices, we observed that the filaments formed were actually made up of iodine vacancies. With these devices, we created what are known as physical unclonable functions. These are essentially cryptographic primitives that is very important for hardware security. And it can be very easily understood by comparing it to our own fingerprints. So just like all of us have a very unique fingerprint, the concept of a PUF is to create a digital fingerprint using the stochastic variations in processes as well as charge transport physics of several devices. So for example, this is today implemented in the industry utilizing silicon. So let's take, for example, an iPhone, two iPhones made in the same factory on the same day using the same process and the same machines. If you take a look at the transistor behavior, billions of transistors that are packed into the IC, there is a lot of difference despite silicon being a very mature process. These variations are currently being utilized to create PUFs. And hence, when we input something known as a challenge, we get different responses for different chips. So we can identify different chips based on these process-induced variations rather than storing ID like an IMEI number on a non-volatile memory or something. So our logic was that halide perovskites have intrinsically a lot of variations within them. These are not only introduced due to processes, but due to the charge transport physics. So for example, the filament formation, even though it can be, correlated to iodide vacancies or iodine migration, there are a lot of physics that goes on behind it, which we still don't know. So it's kind of a black box to even the creator who makes those devices. And hence these are kind of perfect PUF materials. So we can have filament formation by the migration of ions. We can have polarization. We can have electrochemical metallization happening at the same time. We can have anti-site or vacancy formation. So there is a lot of possibility to design PUFs based on halide perovskites. So the concept is again to introduce or to design PUFs that not only depend on process-induced variations, but utilize the stochasticity in the charge transport physics of perovskites to create cryptographic keys. But the key takeaway message is that anything random is not a good puff. So just like our fingerprint should stay stable over our lifetime, the quality of benchmarking metrics for creating a good puff is also very stringent. So we have to measure a lot of devices. So for this, we made 1 kilobyte array of memristors, and we characterized them as 128/8 arrays. And we did a lot of statistical-based studies to prove that the random variations are indeed truly random. We utilized cycle-to-cycle variations to implement what is known as physical reconfigurable puffs, so that in case we suspect any hacking, we are able to reconfigure our puffs on the fly. And we have proved that our devices are resistant to machine learning attacks as well. So how do we do this? Quickly, just to give you an idea, we create a crossbar array of memristors. We compare two cells. We program them both to their high resistance states or HRS. Depending whichever has a lower high resistance state, we classify them as zero, the other as one, and we create this analog map. However, since this is not stable against time, temperature, and voltage, in order to have a high signal to noise ratio, we write back one of the devices to their low resistance state to in turn create this digital map. And we prove over extensive measurements over a large array of devices that this digital key is stable over both time, temperature, as well as voltage fluctuations. What I have not talked about today is the core design of new neuromorphic circuits and algorithms that we have worked on in collaboration with Prof. Basu in NTU. So we have not only worked on devices and small arrays of perovskite devices, we are also one of the first to show simulations of neural networks based on perovskite memristors in both synapses, neurons, as well as nociceptors. With that, I've come to the end of my presentation. Most of my work that I've shown today was done at NTU during my PhD and 1 year of postdoc with Prof. Nripan Matthews, who will also give a talk today. So I would like to thank him for the opportunity. I would like to thank Prof. Basu for the extensive collaborations that we had for the neural network-based studies and other professors who have contributed along the way. Finally, I thank you for your patient listening.